Heads up, because you're in the Hoodwood. I'm a black bandit, KJ Green, welcoming you to Sports from the Hoodwood for February 2nd, 2019. Coming up this week, has AD gone too far to get out of the Big Easy? Why are the big-name free agents in Major League Baseball still unsigned? The 53rd edition of The Big Game, who the Hoodwood thinks will win in Atlanta. Did the All-Star Game get the selections right? The Hoodwood College Group Top 5 is on tap as well. All that, that's a head slap and a multitude of exciting thoughts and opinions in this jam-packed edition of Sports from the Hoodwood. Are you ready? Fasten your seatbelts and let's go.
You're tuned in to Sports from the Hoodwood, the internet's foremost location for the most honest, unfiltered commentary and insight on the world of sports. Now, once again, here's Hoodwood's hometown hero, KJ Green.
Greetings from Hoodwood, where it's still too damn cold for my liking. I didn't get the root canal, but I did end up getting a colon strain, so that was why I was off last week. But I'm back, and better than ever. I'm your man, KJ Green, welcoming you to this week's edition of Sports from the Hoodwood for the first weekend of February 2019. Well, the big game is here, and we'll get to that in a bit, but let's lead off with the growing mess in New Orleans, where their recalcitrant star, Anthony Davis, has made it very clear to the Pelicans that he is not interested in signing a Supermax extension, and has basically said that he wants a trade. He has thought he has done as much as he can in New Orleans, and now feels like he needs to go elsewhere to try to get deep into the postseason. The problem is that Davis isn't supposed to be a free agent until the end of next season. So he's contractually bound to the Pelicans. I always want to call them the Penguins, but that's hockey. Pelicans is basketball. He is contractually obligated to the Pelicans through the rest of this year and the end of next year. The problem is Davis wants the Supermax money. Getting the Supermax money means if he wants to get that Supermax money, he can either get it from the Pelicans or a team that he has traded to next year or through next year. But Davis has made it very clear that any team he has traded to will be basically a year rental, that he will not sign with that team except the Lakers, the team he wants to be traded to, which basically hems up Pelicans from making any kind of deal because no team is going to trade for Anthony Davis knowing he's just going to be a rental. The Lakers are not very serious about what players they're willing to give up. They're actually kind of shuffling around saying, you know, he's going to come here anyway. Why should we throw players at the Pelicans? But Anthony Davis wants the big money. Forcing a trade will give him the ability to sign a Supermax deal with a team that he wants to go to, in this case, the Lakers. The Lakers, of course, are happy to hear about this and are dangling virtually their whole roster, save LeBron James, in front of the Pelicans. Pelicans are not interested. Now, the NBA was none too happy about the public trade demand and fined Davis $50,000 for his public trade demand. Now, I like Davis as a player. He's versatile, packs mean scoring punch, plays good defense, rebounds, and has the overall personality to be a centerpiece of a team. But the Pelicans are a sad lot. And nowhere close to the playoff hunt. Davis knows this, and he has to act fast to get to the team that he wants so he can get the Supermax deal. Now, if he goes to Lakers in free agency in 2020, he will miss out on about $80 million. So, forcing a trade now enables him to re-up with the team that he has traded to. But, in this case, Davis wants to go to the Lakers and has made it clear that being traded to another team, he won't sign anything long term. Now, has Davis gone too far? Now, this is making the situation even messier because the trade deadline is Wednesday the 6th. I think making a fuss to force a trade has damaged his ties with the Pelicans irrevocably. And the Pelicans have gone so far as to take him out of promotional material and made him look like it's about the money and big markets. Now, this may have even further damaged the hoops market in the Big Easy, who has already been on second-class status way behind the Saints. This is going to get messy. Has AD gone too far? Winning is always paramount, with the money being a close second. With players teaming up and teaming up with other players to try to make playoff runs and try to get deep into the postseason, you have to wonder, is it about winning or is it about the money? Or is it about getting as much as you can when you can? Players have had more power now than they ever had at any time. And it's interesting to see players wield power that owners once had to wheel and deal players. Now, we'll look at the All-Star Game reserve picks in a bit, but let's look at the hot stove in the MLB next. Why is, on the first weekend of February, Manny Machado and Bryce Harper still free agents? Why have they not signed with a team? Now, both of them, similar to the Davis situation, have gotten to the point of they've fulfilled their contractual obligations with their original team and now can shop their services to anyone they want. Bryce Harper, who has won a most valuable player and has been, without question, one of the most promising young stars in the game. And keep in mind, he hasn't even hit his 25th birthday. Is looking for a big money, long-term deal with another team. The Nationals have made him an offer, but not to Harper's liking. So he's shopping his services elsewhere. But there haven't been any takers. Many people thought he was going to go to the Yankees. Many people thought he was going to go to a big market like New York or L.A. or Chicago. None of those markets have offered up any interest. Even, I say, secondary big markets like Philly and Houston have both kind of shrugged their shoulders and said, you're nice, but we really can't find any space for you. So far, Bryce Harper's most serious interest is by the Padres. The Padres. Remember, the Padres were a team that used to have fire sales every 3 or 4 years to clear out their roster because they can't afford anybody. The Padres are never in a market for a big-name player. And now, all of a sudden, they're fielding the best offer for Bryce Harper? Are you serious? Manny Machado got traded from the woeful Orioles at the All-Star break last year. Traded to the soon-to-be pennant-winning Dodgers. But he hasn't got more than a few feelers from a couple of teams. The White Sox were rumored to be at the top of the list, but there hasn't been any kind of big splash signings that are typical to the offseason. Manny Machado is still waiting for a team to make him a contract offer to his liking. The biggest free agency signing right now is A.J. Pollock. A.J. Pollock. I mean, he's a decent player, but he's not the superstar potential that Harper and Machado are. I mean, this is just smelling like another version of collusion. And I outlined this a couple of weeks ago where the owners tried this in the mid-80s, got busted, and had to pay $280 million. That was 30 years ago. If they do this again and are caught, they could probably potentially be paying in upwards of billions of dollars. Not hundreds of millions, but I'm talking about multiple billions of dollars. I don't trust the Major League Baseball owners. And they're trying to set the table, once again, for a labor stoppage. The writing is on the wall. And being as hesitant to pay big-name players like that now just seems to smack, even more of sneaky dealings by Major League Baseball owners in an attempt to ruin free agency and keep salaries down, which is something that they've always wanted to do. We will take a timeout, first one of the day, and we will come back with the preview of the big game for Super Bowl 53 between the Rams and the Patriots. We will take a timeout, come right back. You're listening to Sports from the Hoodwood.
You're tuned into Sports from the Hoodwood, the internet's foremost location for no-nonsense commentary, insight, and opinions on the world of sports. Here now live in living color, black by popular demand, your host, KJ Green.
Welcome back to the Hoodwood. I'm KJ Green, and it's story time. Let's break out a story before we get into the big game. Let's gather around for a story. We're going way back to 1959, when the NFL consisted of 12 teams in 11 cities and was just starting to emerge as a force on the sporting landscape. Now, the Colts, who were happily playing in Baltimore, would defeat the New York Football Giants for the second time in as many seasons to win the NFL title. Now, the NFL landscape was primarily a northern and eastern entity. The most southern team in 1959 was Washington, with the Rams and Niners being the only team west of the Mississippi. Now, the Cardinals franchise played in Chicago and was the poor Southside cousins in Comiskey Park to the more affluent and popular Bears who played in Wrigley Field. Now, the Cards were owned by Violet Bidwell Wolfner, widow of Charles Bidwell, who was one of the more senior owners in the NFL at the time. Now, she was besieged by suitors for her ball club who was losing money. The Bidwell family decided to spurn all the suitors and not sell, and instead moved to St. Louis, where for 27 years they would be the football counterpart to a more famous and more successful baseball team of the same name. Now, the Bidwell family still owns the Cards to this day and have since moved on to Arizona, where they have been in the Valley of the Sun longer than they were in St. Louis. Now, one of those spurned suitors for the Cardinals at the time was one Lamar Hunt, who was heir to an oil tycoon fortune. Now, Hunt was frustrated in his bid to buy the Cardinals and annoyed that the NFL showed no signs of expanding beyond its 12-team, soon-to-be 12-city base. Hunt contacted another Texas oil tycoon, Bud Adams, as well as six other high-dollar men, who would-be owners included Baron Hilton, yeah, the hotel owner and Paris's grandfather, Bob Housem in Denver, Billy Sullivan in Boston, and Detroit insurance magnate Ralph Wilson, who was considering Miami, then chose to go to Buffalo because it had a stadium to join his quote-unquote foolish club, which would become the American Football League. Now, first, the NFL was helpful. Then Commissioner Burt Bell gave Hunt a copy of the NFL's constitution and bylaws to give a framework of a setup. Now, Bell seemed to be, at the very least, indifferent to the idea of a new league, but wasn't openly hostile at first. Unfortunately, Bell passed away during the 1959 season at a football game, and the NFL took its time about naming a new commissioner. The 12 owners of the NFL, in contrast, were openly hostile to the thought of a competing league and tried to take steps to kill this league before it got off the ground, creating expansion teams in Dallas and Minneapolis. The former was where Hunt was creating a team, and the latter awarded to owners who were going to create an AFL team in the Twin Cities. They also approved the Cards' move to St. Louis to keep them out of that city as well. Now, these preemptive strikes shut the AFL out of two potential markets and made a third a tough go for the founder of the new league. Now, the AFL had to scramble to find a new owner and market and settled on Oakland, whose initial owner was the enigmatic Chet Soda, who had to be talked out of naming the team the Seniors. Seriously, they were going to name the team the Oakland Seniors. But he settled on the Raiders instead. That team would struggle for the first couple of years, and the soon-to-be iconoclastic Al Davis would join the team as coach in 1963, turning the doormat into a powerhouse. Now, in any case, the AFL launch with 8 teams, and though at times it steady developed as a pro league with teams in new cities of Boston, Buffalo, Denver, and Houston, and teams in established NFL cities of New York and Los Angeles. Now, Dallas was a newly created NFL city, and Oakland was just across the bay from the 49ers, who had been in the NFL a decade. Now, though wobbly, the Chargers having to move downstate to San Diego after one season, and the Texans having to relocate to Kansas City and rebrand in 1963, the league began to establish itself as a solid pro league despite the shaky status of the Raiders, the ineptness of the Titans' ownership, they would later become the Jets, and the hideousness of the Broncos' brown and yellow vertically striped socks. Take a look up of that if you want a real good laugh. After gaining a TV contract with NBC in 1965 that added a nice cash infusion to the teams, the AFL stepped up its pursuit of the best college players. Now, the problem started when Giants kicker Pete Gogolak played out his option with the New York Giants and signed with the Buffalo Bills, becoming the first NFL player to jump leagues, breaking the so-called gentleman's agreement between these two leagues. Now, this enraged the NFL, who went about trying to destroy the AFL with a big money bidding war. But the AFL hung in, and the number of players who were drafted by teams in both leagues increased dramatically. Now, when Raiders GM Al Davis became commissioner of the AFL in 1966 and openly tried to recruit established NFL stars to jump to the AFL, this started a series of negotiations that the NFL initiated, not the AFL, the NFL initiated these, that would end the bidding war and merge the two leagues. Not only did this bring about a merger, both leagues were creating teams that would bring pro football to what was once considered far-flung outposts like Atlanta, Miami, New Orleans, and Cincinnati. In June 1966, a merger between the AFL and the NFL was announced for the 1970 season, and a creation of a world championship game between the two leagues was announced for January 1967. Now, this was initially called the AFL-NFL Championship Game. The first matchup between the Packers and the Chiefs was a 35-10 rout in favor of the established Packers, and to some, confirmation that the AFL was still way out of their league. Although what many overlook in this game was the game was only 14-10 at the half, and a Packers interception in the third quarter that set up a score, making it 21-10, was a key point in the game. Now, the game was nicknamed the Super Bowl, but NFL Commissioner Pete Rozelle hated the name, and he initially wanted to call the game the Pro Bowl, but that was already in use as NFL's All-Star Game. Now, with no workable alternatives, eventually the name became official with the third game and retrofitting the first two to be Super Bowls 1 and 2. That game, the third game, was the historic Jets upset of the seemingly invincible 13-1 18-point favorite Colts that gave the AFL much more credibility, and with the Chiefs thumping the Vikings in the fourth Super Bowl, the last game for an AFL team as its own league, the game was seen more and more as the crown jewel of the pro game. Now, the NFL went on to become a 2016 two-conference entity with the Super Bowl as its championship game and has grown to the 32-team behemoth you see today. The game has grown in stature as being the most watched sporting event every calendar year, and the top four most watched broadcasts in U.S. history are Super Bowl games. Now, the broadcast rights and commercial spots are highly coveted as it rotates among the networks. It's pretty much almost become a de facto national holiday. And how much food has been consumed? Over 1.1 billion chicken wings will be consumed on Super Bowl Sunday. And Pizza Hut reports that over 2 million pizzas will be ordered just in the hours before the game. In terms of total food consumption, only Thanksgiving ranks higher in consumption. Now, you're going to fast forward back to the present day where the Super Bowl is the crown jewel of football, the dream of every football player to win. Now, the winning team this year will get a $118,000 payday, but it's an almost 2-foot-high, 7-pound Tiffany Silver trophy that is the desire, the Lombardi trophy. Now, the best quote I've ever heard about the Super Bowl was from Johnny Davis, who was a reserve running back for the 49ers when they won their first Super Bowl after the 1981 season. He said, quote, "The money is nice, but I'll spend that. It's the ring that lasts forever." So now you have a bit of insight on how we've come to the de facto sporting holiday known as Super Bowl Sunday. Let's look at Super Bowl 53, LIII. The number, the Roman numerals are just getting too unwieldy for me now. But Super Bowl 53 has New England Patriots, who are 13-5, as the number 2 AFC, versus the Los Angeles Rams, who are 15-3, and the number 2 NFC seed. This will be played at Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. 6:30 kickoff on CBS. Jim Nantz on the play-by-play. Tony Romo with color commentary and analysis. Tracy Wolfson and Evan Washburn are the sideline reporters. Patriots are 2-point favorites. Here's some fast facts on the game. This is the first time since 2012 that neither of the conference's top seeds made it to the Super Bowl. This is the third time that the Super Bowl is being played in Atlanta, but it's the first for this venue. The first two were being played at the old Georgia Dome. First-time coaches are 27-26 in the Super Bowl since the 1970 merger. Teams that are wearing white, which the Patriots are wearing, have won 33 of the 52 Super Bowls and 12 of the last 14. Now, the Rams have the choice of jersey as a designated home team and will wear their old-school throwback blue jerseys. Now, there has yet to be a shutout in the Super Bowl, and only one game, Patriots over the Falcons 2 years ago, has gone to overtime. The Patriots have not scored a touchdown in the first quarter of any of their Super Bowl appearances. And in the Brady Belichick era, all of their Super Bowls have been decided by 8 points or less. Last meeting between the two teams, Patriots won 26-10 in 2016 and have won the last 5 meetings, including their only meeting in Super Bowl 36, and lead the all-time series 8-5. So look at the AFC champion New England Patriots. They were 11-5 as AFC East champions in the regular season. Their head coach is Bill Belichick, who's 254-89 in 19 seasons with New England, 291-134 in 22 seasons overall with New England and Cleveland, 261-123 in the regular season and 30-11 in the playoffs. He is aiming to be the first coach to win 6 Super Bowls and has the most playoff wins of any NFL coach. They are in the first round bye as AFC's number 2 seed, defeating the AFC number 2 wild card LA Chargers in the divisional round 41-28, and defeating the AFC West champion Kansas City Chiefs 37-31 in the AFC Championship. Team leaders Tom Brady has 4,355 yards, 29 touchdowns, and 11 interceptions. Sony Michel has 931 yards rushing and 6 TDs. James White leads the team in receiving with 87 receptions for 751 yards and 7 TDs. Julian Edelman also 74 receptions for 850 yards and 6 TDs. Kyle Van Noy on defense led the team with 92 tackles. Duron Harmon had 4 interceptions. In the Super Bowl, the Patriots have 5 wins, 36 over the St. Louis Rams, 38 over Carolina, 39 over Philadelphia, 49 over Seattle, and 51 over Atlanta. 5 losses, 20 against Chicago, 31 against Green Bay, 42-46 against the New York Football Giants, and last year, 53 to Philadelphia. Fast fact, final for the Patriots. New England has the most Super Bowl appearance of any team in the NFL, and 9 of 11 of those appearances have come in the Belichick-Brady era. On the other side, we have the NFC champion Los Angeles Rams, who are 13-3. Their head coach is Sean McVay, who's 26-9 in his second season in L.A. They are in the first round bye as the NFC's number 2 seed. And in the playoffs, they defeated the NFC East champion Dallas Cowboys 30-22 in the NFC divisional round. And then they defeated the NFC South champion New Orleans Saints 26-23 in the NFC Championship. Team leaders, Jared Goff threw for 4,688 yards, 32 touchdowns. Todd Gurley led the team in rushing with 1,251 yards. Robert Woods led the team in receptions with 86 catches for 1,219 yards. On defense, Aaron Donald led the NFL with 20.5 sacks. Corey Littleton had 90 solo tackles and 125 total. John Johnson led the defense with 4 interceptions. In the Super Bowl, they have 1 win, 34 against Tennessee, 2 losses, 14 against Pittsburgh, and 36 to the New England Patriots. Fast fact is the Rams joined the Raiders and Colts as the only teams to have reached the Super Bowl representing two different cities. Now let's look at when the teams have the ball. When the Patriots have the ball, where do you think you start with the Pats? Irrepressible, seemingly ageless Tom Brady, who at 41 doesn't look like he's slowing down any. He's getting more ruthless and efficient with age. He runs an offense that can track meet you or grind it out, and probably make some of the best adjustments on the fly in the game. Now, Sony Michel has been an impressive rookie running back, and while James White has become a versatile tool receiving out of the backfield, while Julian Edelman and the ageless Rob Gronkowski are reliable veteran targets. Now, for the Rams, Aaron Donald has led the NFL in sacks and must be accounted for on every play. Now, that opens up Ndamukong Suh, Corey Littleton, and Dante Fowler to make tackles in space and clog running lanes. Now, when the Rams have the ball, the Rams can wheel between the versatile running of Todd Gurley and the dynamic passing of Jared Goff. C.J. Anderson has been a very valuable pickup late in the season to be able to spell the off-injured Gurley. Pushing the ball downfield with an explosive vertical offense, the Rams scored 23 or more points in all of their wins and were only held under the 23-point mark only once all season. Brandon Cooks and Robert Woods are explosive vertical weapons that can stretch a defense. Now, the Pats have a bend but don't break defense that adjusts to their opposition and takes away their primary option. Patrick Chung and the McCourty twins, Devin and Jason, anchor an underrated secondary. We're looking at coaching. The Patriots have been the gold standard in the NFL of the 21st century. They have not had a losing season since 2000, and that is because of Bill Belichick, who turned a middling franchise into a perennial double-digit winner every year since 2001. Now, Belichick is frumpy, grumpy, mumbles seemingly all the time. But behind the mumbles and grumbles is a stone-cold killer coach who makes adjustments on the fly better than almost anyone in the league and has proven consistently to win with all different types of personnel. Now, Sean McVay, at 32, is a definition of the hot young mind, but he is cut from deep football stock. His grandfather, John, was GM of the old 49ers in their Super Bowl heyday, and his father was a college defensive back. Sean has basically been a football lifer. His dynamic offensive schemes have made him a hot coaching name before he even got into his 30s, and it has taken him two seasons to get the Rams from a 4-12 mess that Jeff Fisher left him to the NFL championship game. Now, the Patriots win if, on defense, they keep Gurley and possibly C.J. Anderson bottled up and force Jared Goff to consistently check down and away from Woods and Cooks. On offense, they must contain Aaron Donald and keep Aqib Talib from making big plays. Now, the Rams have won every game that Donald has had one or more sacks in, so keeping him contained is a premium. Sony Michel and James White will be key, with the former being a sledgehammer in the running game and the latter being a valuable checkdown for Brady to grind out yards and points and, more importantly, keep the Rams' offense off the field. Now, the Rams win if they hit Brady and hit him consistently. The Giants and Eagles have shown the way to beat the Pats is to disrupt Brady's timing and to constantly get in his face. Jared Goff has to stay poised and not let the Pats puzzle him with exotic schemes and defensive fronts. Getting Gurley and or C.J. Anderson rolling early is also key. This will force the Patriots to stay honest in their defensive assignments and not try to wheel around to any kind of exotic blitz or throw any kind of exotic defensive looks at Goff. Finally, the pick. Now, the story has come full circle. 17 years ago, their first meeting in New Orleans, the Rams were the established team, with the Pats being the plucky underdog. Now, the Rams are the plucky, quote-unquote, underdog, and the Pats are the established team. Now, the Pats are treating this like a business. They have no use for feel-good stories, And like his college counterpart in Nick Saban, if you give Bill Belichick time to prepare, he will formulate a game plan to destroy you. The Rams need to get Aaron Donald into Brady's face early. Hit him a couple of times, maybe even get a couple of sacks, and pound him into mistakes. Now, Goff has to be consistent and spread the ball around. Now, I don't know how Brady does it. He should have been slowed down a long time ago. But he makes the plays, get his team down the field and into the end zone. And keeping the Rams' offense off the field is probably going to be their best defense. I think that James White will be the real X factor here. His running, his receiving, and the Pats will enable the Pats' ability to slow the game down and grind it out. This time, the Rams will not have the answers for not being able to be on the field and to make points. The call here is Patriots 31, Rams 21. The Patriots join the Steelers as six-time Super Bowl winners. There you have it. We will take a timeout. Come back with some more information about the NBA All-Star Game and debut the Hoodwood College Basketball Hot 5. Sports from the Hoodwood rolls on after this timeout.
You're tuned in to Sports from the Hoodwood, the internet's premier location for no-nonsense commentary, insight, and opinion on the world of sports. Here now, the man with 100% certified fresh taste, your host, KJ Green.
You are back in the Hoodwood. Let's jump back into some hoops, both pro and college. And we'll step back to the NBA All-Star Game, which will be on February 17th. The All-Star Game selections have LeBron James from the West and Giannis Antetokounmpo are as the All-Star captains. And they will pick the starters and reserves. They will have a draft of players. And they have a pool of players that the fans selected who will be the starters. And the coaches selected who will be with the reserves. Now, some of these starters and reserves include Nikola Jokic from Denver and Karl-Anthony Towns, the latter being moved to tears by his selection by the coaches, which I salute both players. They have earned their slots as All-Star players. Puzzling snubs were Rudy Gobert and Landon Mitchell from Utah, the former being moved to tears by his omission. And also missing from the All-Star Game will be rookie sensation Luka Doncic of the Mavs, Jimmy Butler of the Sixers, and Draymond Green of the Warriors. Now, I sit back and look at the All-Star Game selections and wonder what kind of motivation do these coaches have when they're picking these players? I honestly think that they go around and look and see, okay, who are getting bonuses, who aren't, who is just going to be, you know, what big names can we select for this game, you know, and some of these selections, Rudy Gobert missed out on $1 million bonus for missing the All-Star Game. I don't think that's the reason he was upset. I think he played good enough to be on the All-Star Games, on the All-Star Game roster. Same thing with Landon Mitchell. Landon Mitchell was a Rookie of the Year last year. And he has not slacked off from his play from last year to this year. I don't understand what goes into the criteria for selecting. Now, we all know that the fans select the starters. The fans got it right. You know, picking players like Steph Curry, James Harden. Kemba Walker was a really interesting pick that made the All-Star East starters. Giannis Antetokounmpo and LeBron James, of course, being the top two vote getters, are the captains, so they get to draft their teams. Now, they're doing the draft this year in public, which I like. Last year, they made the selection, and it was like, okay, here's the selections. They made them in secret, so they didn't offend anybody. I think having all the players there that are on the rosters and having the two captains, King James and the Greek Freak picking their teams like pickup game, I think sparks controversy, sparks talk, and I think some of these omissions were done to do the exact same thing. But I don't like it. Don't like it a bit. It is just, to me, I think some of the selection process, the coaches don't have to defend their picks or their omissions. They just make the picks and say, here it is. Here are the players that I want on the teams. And James and Antetokounmpo will have to make the selection. I don't like it, personally. Let's shift gears to the Hoodwood Hot 5. Now, the Hoodwood Hot 5 is like college football, Hoodwood Hot 5. At five topics, or I should say four topics, and then the top 10 of who I think is the top 10 teams in the league. Now, they may or may not necessarily follow the same top 10 as you see in the AP and the coaches. That's where it sparked conversation. Like I said, it's just four real quick hit topics. Make you think, make you wonder about some things that are going on the college campuses. Starting off with the Hoodwood Hot 5, the first topic I have is a ruling of DeSouza of Kansas being named ineligible. How are you going to suspend a player that got supposed that for money that he didn't get or knew nothing about? But you're going to suspend him not only for this season, but the rest of next season. The NCAA, in its quote-unquote wisdom and ruling power, are just going too far. DeSouza will probably never play another college basketball game again. I am almost for certain that he will go ahead and just jump to the NBA. Because why is he going to sit around and why is Sylvia DeSouza going to just sit around and wait till the fall of 2020? We're still in the winter of 2019. Why is he going to wait almost 2 years to be able to play college basketball? If I were him, I'd just go ahead and jump to the NBA if the appeal was turned down. Now, Iowa is, again, proving to be a dangerous locale for ranked teams. They zapped Michigan on Friday night, handing the Wolverines their second overall loss. And it wasn't close, 74-59. And Michigan looked befuddled, bewildered, and another victim of the Iowa City jinx. My beloved Bearcats are 18-3 and are not ranked. This is a travesty. The so-called bracketology experts have them in a 7-10 slot. Why? This team has proven to be good. Do they deserve a number 2 or number 3 seeding in the NCAA tournament? No. I'm thinking more of a 5 or a 6. But you put them in a 7-10 slot, anywhere from 7-10 in a seeding is dangerous. You win your first game, and who do you get? A number 1 team looking at you going, now, my Bearcats were number 2 seed and got knocked out by a 7 seed Nevada, a 7 seed I thought was a lot stronger than they should have been seeded last year, but that's neither here nor there. I still think the Bearcats are getting the shaft. And a memo to Penny Hardaway, start winning. Then the coaches might be jealous. But this whole carping about Penny Hardaway carping about, oh, coaches are jealous of him because he was in the NBA and he knows people and this and that, it's stupid. Let's just put it like that. It is outright stupid. Penny Hardaway is the coach of Memphis, first-year coach. Yes, he has a lot of connections in the Memphis area. Yes, he has one in high school and has parlayed his coaching in Western Tennessee into a coaching job at his alma mater at University of Memphis. But he is sitting around carping that coaches are jealous of him, which I think is a farce. If he was 20-1, maybe, But his NBA background is not eliciting jealousy. Memphis is 12-9. And as the show is being recorded, they're getting hammered by South Florida in Tampa. Jealousy? I don't think so. Win games. Right now, you're just a middling coach that talks too much. And personally, I always thought Penny Hardaway was overrated. When he played, I thought he was overrated. My man Nick Van Exel shut him down when they played. The thing I don't understand is why the big talk now. Yeah, they beat preseason favorite American preseason conference favorite UCF by 20 points last week, but they're still 13-7. They still have to deal with my beloved Bearcats, who I'm hoping and praying that they beat the pants off of. They got run off the court by Tennessee, and Hardaway jabbed back and forth with Rick Barnes. Rick Barnes was winning games before you got into high school. Holmes, you need to quit it. Stop it. Hoodwood top 10 looks like this. From 1 to 10, from 10 to 1. We'll start from 10 to 1. Number 10, I have Kansas. Number 9 is Marquette. Number 8, North Carolina. Number 8, Nevada. Number 7, UK. Number 6, Michigan State. Number 5, Gonzaga. No, I'm going to try that again. We'll edit that out. Number 10, Kansas. Number 9, Marquette. Number 8, UNC. Number 7, Nevada. Number 6, UK. Number 5, Michigan State. Number 4, Gonzaga. Number 3, Duke. Number 2, Virginia. The number 1 team in the Hoodwood top 10 is Tennessee. So we'll go back through these next week with the last week, and if they've moved up or down. But that's the initial Hoodwood top 10 in the Hoodwood Hot 5. We will take a final timeout, come back with the Fat Dap, Head Slap, and the final word from the Wood as Sports from the Hoodwood heads down the home stretch after this.
Tuned into Sports from the Hoodwood, the internet's foremost location for the most honest insight and opinion on the world of sports. Now, once again, here's the man of the hour, After Hours, your host, KJ Green.
Rounding third and heading for home here in the Hoodwood. Let's see, the Fat Dap and Head Slap of the week. Get things real quick. The Fat Dap goes to the Rockets, James Harden. Finished January with a 43.3-point game average for the month. 43.3 points. That's like Maravich-like numbers from college or something. But he has still continued a streak of 26 straight 30-point-plus games. He's basically keeping the Rockets afloat in the playoff race. Head slap to the New Orleans Saints fans who are continuing to carp about the non-pass interference call in the conference championship games, and recently just lost a suit to the NFL, an NFL in court, to replay the game from the point that the call wasn't made. Hey, Saints fans, your team lost. Get over it. The call was missed. I know it sucks, but get over it. Seriously. And now, without any further ado, since this show is running kind of long anyway, here is the final word from the Wood, short and sweet. This past Thursday would have been the 100th birthday of one Jack Roosevelt Robinson. We all know him as Jackie. The first marks the start of Black History Month. Sports, not just baseball, owes an unpayable debt to Mr. Robinson. This is the man who paved the way. 7 years before the historic Brown versus Board of Topeka decision that made segregated schools unconstitutional, 12 years before the first person of color to be president was born, a brown-eyed handsome man stepped on the field in Brooklyn and made his debut, breaking the so-called color line in baseball. Robinson paved the way and made it possible for any man or woman of color to be in numerous fields. His widow Rachel, looking grand in her 90s, still a vocal critic of the game and its fading ability to fuel social change and justice. Jackie Robinson was at the World Series in Cincinnati in 1972 in what would ultimately be his final public appearance 9 days before his death. Still rocking the boat, still calling for change, calling for the game to have managers and general managers of color. This would be a position that Frank Robinson would ultimately fill and be the first to fill in both leagues. In 1974 as the manager of the Cleveland Indians, and then in 1982 as manager of the San Francisco Giants. Jackie Robinson was asked to fill a monumental task in breaking the color barrier in baseball, to be strong enough to fight, but smart and wise enough to know not to. The stress and turmoil of this that the burden gave to him and that he carried ultimately took his life far younger than it should have. Pictures of Robinson showed a man who looked far older than the early 50s that he was when he passed away. Being a social justice warrior took its toll, and the game owes a debt that it could never repay. No one in Major League Baseball now wears the number 42. Major League Baseball retired that number in 1997, and the number slowly made its way to the stadium's various hallowed land of retired numbers of every team. In a bit of sweet irony, the last man to wear number 42 in Major League Baseball was Yankees closer Mariano Rivera, who became the first player to be unanimously elected to baseball's Hall of Fame, an honor I think wearing number 42 makes even sweeter. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. The world owes you a debt of thanks as well. The world, not just the sporting landscape, is in your debt for the high speeds that they now travel on the road that you worked so hard and ultimately gave your life to pay. And that is the final word from the Wood. With the music coming up in the background, you know that means your time in the Hoodwood is just about done. I thank you for your visit this week. Email for the show is kjgreen@blackbanditproductions.com. You can send me emails on various show topics, questions, comments, praise, and criticism. I welcome your correspondence and try to reply to every email in a timely manner. You can get this podcast on a number of sites, iTunes, and Google Play. The show site itself is hoodwoodsports.podbean.com, which has previous show and will soon be updated with other links, videos, and other interesting stuff. I'm also on Facebook at Black Bandit Productions and Enterprises. I'm on Twitter as well at KJG20. And KJ Green TV, as well as So that's that, fellow sports fans. Until next time out in the Hoodwood, I'm KJ Green.
Sports from the Hoodwood is a Black Bandit Productions and Enterprises presentation of a 551.